On the show today,
we meet the amazing Kalki Koechlin, the very talented actress who's pregnant now.
My first trimester was a lot of vomiting. I was really, really not in good shape.
We talked about being multicultural.
It takes a lot of us time to understand and value that being different is good.
We talked about saving the earth and lots more.
It saved the planet.
Our Absolutely.
Biggest home is actually the planet.
Absolutely.
And that's under huge threat right now.
I hope the powers that be honestly hear the fact that development needs to be responsible. We have a supremely talented guest here with us. She's a national award-winning actress, a director, a writer. She has her own podcast. She's super multicultural and she's superly, stunningly pregnant, the beautiful Kalki Koechlin.
Thank you, Tara. You got my name right. Wow.
Yes.
Yeah. But
thank
you've hung out enough for you to get my name right.
Yeah, I think we have. And also, I'm so, so grateful for you to be on the show. And you are looking absolutely amazing. I know you've heard this before, but you're really a stunning pregnant
mama.
Yeah.
Well, you know, one talking to another. I saw you in your pregnant stage and just literally just a bump.
But that's it. I mean, thank you. That's very flattering. Honestly, I don't want to give advice because I know that's one thing I think pregnant women get too much of.
Yes, it's already started nonstop. And now because of the age of the internet, people find any rubbish to send you, you know?
I'm sure. And you have to like take it in one ear, out the other.
Yeah.
The stuff that you agree with,
take it. The rest of it, say thank you.
Exactly. So now pregnancy, of course, I want to chat about. But because this is all a show about inspiring people who are using their platforms to bring about positive change, something that I've known about you even before I got to know you is that you really seem to have broken into an industry or into a space, if you like, where you've done things on your own term. Do you think that your childhood had a part to play in that?
I'm sure. I think the fact that I grew up in South India, but with French parents, but speaking Tamil and going to a English medium school, I was always shifting and adapting.
Yeah.
For different environments.
Yeah.
In my school, it was a very good Protestant, lovely school where we pray before every meal.
Jane.
And then I was in a home where there was no religion.
Yeah.
And, you know, we went and meditated at the Matri Mandir.
Yeah.
And then I was playing gully cricket with my Tamilian friends on the street with the fishermen kids.
Yeah.
So, you know, I had to be with like very different kinds of people in society. And so I learned to adapt quickly to things.
That is so fascinating. I have to say, I'm half Indian and half English. And although I look very Indian and I've been born and brought up in Bombay, and I'm so grateful for everything I've done in the Indian film industry and what I do here, there's a small part of me that always feels like I need to make my own space because of being mixed.
Mm.
I remember, you know, if we were told to bring snacks to school and they'd say like, something in Gujarati, like, huh, just make some dhokla. And my mom would like put chicken sausages in and I'd be like, uh-huh. Almost, you know, like, oh, no, don't.
Yeah.
So did you ever feel like you didn't fit in? I felt
it's
I
funny,
fit
yeah.
in, but I'm just
yeah,
curious about
it's
that.
It's funny,
whole
the dhokla story, because I had a similar thing happen to me when I went to visit my grandparents in France. They signed me up on the sailing club.
Yeah.
And so we had to bring packed lunches and my packed lunch had like pickle and stuff in it, you know?
Yeah.
And these French kids. Achar and all. And these French kids are like, ew, what's that? It's so smelly. And I was like, oh shit, I'm the masala kid, you know?
Yeah.
And so I remember that. But of course, I always stood out, but my whole effort was to fit in. So
yeah.
I would literally change my accent. Na Tamil pesra and the Marita pesra, and then oh, oui, maman, je sais, you know, I'll be all good at home.
But
because
look at
I have
how amazingly that must have trained you to be such a fantastic actress, because
but,
you did
yeah,
that as
I guess,
a kid. You did that naturally. It's so interesting because I clearly remember there was an age when it became so cool to say I was mixed.
Mm.
You know, till a certain age, it was about fitting in.
Now everyone is mixed, right?
And it's so cool. I think it's nice to appreciate that diversity. And I think
Absolutely.
Acceptance and understanding that everyone's the same, however different we are.
Yeah, and we're just all different shades of beige.
Yeah. So
there's no more color anymore. It's like everyone's mixed up together.
Yeah, absolutely. And I read when I was doing some research on you about how when people would say, you know, how come you speak an Indian language and you don't look it, or the
right.
other way around. And you said that, you know, on the outside, I may look this color, but inside I'm...
My heart is brown, my skin is white.
It really resonated. So as a kid, were you a naughty kid? Were you a conforming kid? What kind of kid were you?
I was a very clever kid because I would know where to conform and where to be naughty. And I was very naughty in class, but I was a teacher's pet. So when teacher was out, I was making dirty jokes. I was like grabbing boys and kissing them.
Yeah,
I was terrible, terrible.
Really?
Yeah, and you know how boys have that phase right before they get like puberty, where they hate girls?
Yeah.
I would find it really fun to go and chase them and like try to kiss them and stuff. And they'd be like, oh, we'll get girl disease. And then back at home, my mother was a disciplinarian. So I was very quiet, very different at home. So yeah, I think boarding school, like rowdy kid.
Yeah.
And then back home, like quiet, good, you know, reading kid.
So now that you're about to become a mummy, do you think that you're going to do some of the things your parents did with you, or do you think you're going to have a whole different approach? Or
yeah, it's a mix of both. There are good things and bad things. I want to take some from my parents and not take others. What I love is that they've been very organic in terms of the community that we grew up in Pondicherry. It was a lot of people around all the time.
Yeah.
And, you know, my mom had a natural birth at home. Literally, it was 5 a.m. There was no electricity. My dad was holding a kerosene lamp.
Really?
And the midwife was, you know, getting me out.
Wow, so no epidural, nothing?
No epidural. I don't know if I'm having a natural birth, not at home, but in a birth clinic. So I will have the option of medicine if it's needed.
Yeah.
But I'll see if I don't, you know.
Yeah, I think as we were saying earlier, you take things as it comes.
You have to be open-minded.
Absolutely. And I think, as you said earlier, you don't know what the day will bring. Like, it's the most amazing thing, painful and all that, but whether it's natural, whether it's cesarean, whether there's epidural, whatever, it's amazing.
You can't control the situation.
Absolutely.
I feel like it's like a theater show.
Yeah.
It's going to be a live audience theater show, and there's sometimes things go wrong. Some actor forgets a line, something breaks on stage. You have to be ready to like improvise, make things up or change.
Absolutely.
You can't go exactly according to your script.
Absolutely. But I read somewhere that you're thinking of doing a water birth, or is that, do you have to prepare for that, or how does it work?
In terms of just being a little fit and keeping your exercise going, I'm actually haven't started these birthing classes, which I'll be starting in a month's time, where, you know, you learn certain breathing techniques. There's also hypnobirthing techniques, which is supposed to help calm the pain down.
Yeah.
Yeah. Other than that, you know, obviously you're not supposed to just sit on your bum and eat sugar for 9 months.
Exactly. And I think that's one of the things that the show is all about. Without being a martyr, it's about trying to help. And I think that's so important because there's so many myths, you know, and to give everyone the respect that they do, you do what works for you, but at the same time, there's certain things that are just not true. Like, you don't have to eat loads to at all.
I think I've been healthier during pregnancy than before.
Yeah.
Because I get checked up every 2 weeks by my gynec.
Yeah.
And we're checking like protein levels and glucose and, you know, just all of these things, weight, of course. So, you know, we kind of have a much better idea of what we need, what we don't need.
Absolutely.
You know, I've cut out most carbs. I'm eating a lot more protein. I wasn't so healthy before.
Yeah, no, but it makes you do that. And once you have one, once you have your little baby, you'll be like, really making sure that they're okay as well, of course, so you do everything for them. Coming up,
save the planet.
Absolutely.
Our biggest home is actually the planet.
Absolutely.
And that's under huge threat right now.
I hope the powers that be honestly hear the fact that development needs to be responsible. So tell us a little bit about Guy.
Guy, yeah, you know.
Israeli.
Guy, he's Israeli. He's from Jerusalem, and he's a pianist and a composer.
Oh,
and
lovely.
A classical musician. A very, very calm personality compared to me.
See,
I think we balance each other well, because I'm like, oh, I have to do 10 things in a day.
Yeah, I think
and
that sounds familiar.
Spend 10 hours on the piano a day, you know, like.
That's so lovely. That sounds familiar, and it looks like you're expanding the multicultural dimension of your family.
Yeah, he's half Iranian. His mother's side is Iranian,
really?
And his father's side is Russian Polish. So,
wow.
Yeah, that's like a huge mix in our blood.
That's like a huge mix. So I think, again, it's so great because you can celebrate diversity, let the kid, the child, your beautiful baby appreciate that all these differences and living here in Bombay, in India.
Yeah.
So that child is going to have a lot to learn from. And I think in life, to me, it is all about keeping on learning, right? Whatever you're doing, you're always learning. There's never a time when you're like, I know all this. And I have to say, every performance I've seen you in, you've been spectacular. Aww. And I'm not just saying that, but really, I think there's something different that you bring to everything. And I think that it comes through because you're always seeking and learning and doing things on your own terms. So, Kalki, is there any cause that you feel really strongly about or anything that you're particularly passionate about?
There's many. I think women, of course, is one.
Yeah.
Just because, you know, I'm a woman and it just seems right to look after my own rights.
Yeah, of course.
I think a new one for me has become environment. It's the elephant in the room right now.
Absolutely.
Because every city in India, I mean, some statistic like 25 out of the 30 worst cities in the world are in India. And we are only talking about Delhi, but it's also some of the second tier cities. Definitely Bombay's on its way.
Yeah.
I don't know why every government is not panicking and like changing legislation in order for this to happen. You know, I have an air purifier and it measures like the
air quality
and it goes different colors. And many times it's red, which is like toxic air.
I know.
You're like, why is no one talking about this or doing anything about it? And masks are not a solution. So I get really like, wow, this is something we really need to like talk about.
I feel tremendously passionately about this as well. And I do think that I hope the powers that be honestly hear the fact that development needs to be responsible. I think, unfortunately, there's a huge emphasis on development and that is supposed to show progress when actually everywhere in the world, it's all about actually cutting back on anything that's destroying the environment and developing with sustainability, long-term views. You stand up for stuff and you're vocal about things and all. Sometimes I feel I won't say afraid, but I don't really like do it in the same way. But over the last year, been very concerned about saving the coast and saving RA and all these things. And I think as a mom, I feel now it's our duty to show the kids that you have to stand up. It's not about a fight. It's about speaking up so that it's for everyone.
It's save the planet.
Absolutely.
Our biggest home is actually the planet.
Absolutely.
And that's under huge threat right now. It's almost at the point of being irreversible.
Absolutely.
In which case, we as individuals all have to make our small moves.
I completely agree. I've been quite feeling upset about a coastal road that's going to destroy 200 acres of the sea to make a road of which only 20% will be a road. It troubles me because I feel that's more real estate than it is transport.
It's all about money, isn't it? And
that's what's upsetting. And I don't think I started this conversation expecting it to go in this direction, but that's what's so lovely about having a chat with somebody who's honestly passionate about things, because these are such important things. I think for all our kids, it's quite heartbreaking to think that they have to like breathe in bad air or, you know.
My brother got married in Japan because his wife's from Japan.
Another dimension to the multiculturalism.
Yeah, we have so many countries involved. But so, you know, we were in Japan and the first thing I realized is in rush hour, it was silent. I was like, why are the cars not making sound? It's because every single vehicle in Kyoto was electric. So, you know, you just realize that how far we still have to go.
Absolutely.
You know, when we look at our public transport and the kind of exhaust that comes out of there, you know, that's something that is
worrying.
And a demand we can make on our government. And also like big businesses putting out that awareness is really important. Because of course, all of us individually can get our compost bins. We can order non-chemical products, you know, so that, you know, the sewage system and things like that are not completely poisoned. So all of this is individual. But like there was supposed to be this huge plastic ban and then it just got canceled. Maybe it's just too big a commitment or I don't know what it is.
On the positive side, I've seen again, because I've been following this whole coastal thing, it's actually been quite amazing to see how the power of people and the judiciary can come together to actually say, listen, stop, let's check things out. It's not about politics, it's not about anything, it's about everyone.
Mm.
And I believe one of the senior advocates said, this is not them versus thee, this concerns us all. And I think to me that's so telling because this does concern us all our kids. And I think once you're a parent, these things really bother you even more, I feel.
Like, politicians are going to breathe the same air that we're going to breathe.
And, you know, that's a topic I feel passionately about too. So that was nice that you brought it in. And so, Kalks, what about, are you vegan? No.
No, I'm not. I'm vegetarian.
Are you thinking?
Well, I was vegetarian. But now that I'm pregnant, I've been eating a lot of fish.
Yeah.
Because I need more protein. You know, milk I don't drink. So yeah. I was very happy to see it.
There's a bunch of things there. You're already looking at your gift. The chat
I mean,
is not over.
I'm really hard for this.
Yeah,
okay?
I know. The chat is not over.
Dinner.
But I've seen you eyeing that. So I'm going to...
Baby's cooking.
Yeah. I'm going to gift you this. Don't worry. It's coming. You're
Thank
away.
God. If you weren't, I would have been like, I'll quit right now.
It's really heavy.
Is
but
it?
Like, we're very
no,
thick
don't
mamas.
Don't give me heavy things.
I know.
I have a heavy thing right here.
I won't give you a heavy thing, but this is a gift of all kinds of assorted stuff, including good source of protein and all that. I'm gifting it to you so you can hold it and like pretend to take it, but it's heavy.
Yeah, yeah.
And you know, I'm very mindful because I've been pregnant twice, so I know that you are very fit, but you don't want to like overdo it. So that is a gift for you.
Okay, right here.
See, it is. Okay. So if you had to give anyone advice, one pregnancy related, what you're feeling and how you're feeling and what you would... One tip that you would give any young moms out there, pregnant moms?
I don't think I'm experienced enough to give advice to young moms. And plus, I hate that thing of people giving advice.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think what I would like to say is I've gone through so many tough parts and I feel like men are so clueless about it, you know, in terms of like get your facts out there, right? If you're a partner, family member, like, you know, find out some of these things. Like my first trimester was a lot of vomiting, a lot of weakness. I lost weight. I was really, really not in good shape.
Yeah.
And that's something we don't really talk about.
Yeah.
And, you know, I just feel like whether it's colleagues or bosses or partners, people in a pregnant woman's life should have some information on all of that.
Absolutely. I think that's a really, really good, it's not advice and it's not a tip, but, you know, because this show is about helping.
Yeah.
It's a suggestion that if you have someone around you who's pregnant, read up a bit, know a bit.
Yeah.
But I think everyone's situation is different. Every person is different, reacts differently to it. So it's also a little bit of that.
Totally.
I think
everyone
has a different experience at some level.
For sure.
Coming up.
I think it takes a lot of us time to understand and value that being different is good.
I completely agree. I think celebrating who you are and not being afraid to be that is just so important. Anything you'd like to say to anyone who is also multicultural like us? Anything you'd like to say about this whole fitting in or not fitting in or just be who you are?
I think it took me a long time to understand the value of being different. I always wanted to fit in, as you were saying. And even in London when I was there, I was like talking like a little British person.
Yeah, like talking like this.
Yes,
like, should we talk in English?
Yeah, exactly, like that.
Yeah.
So I could fit in. But I realized, I remember doing a project where I had to write a theater piece in university. And I wrote about my little village in South India.
Yeah.
And I got like really good marks for it. And, you know, our professor was basically like, you know what? That's what you need to focus on. The fact that you have this completely different thing that nobody has experienced.
Yeah.
So I think it takes a lot of us time to understand and value that being different is good.
Yeah, yeah. No, I do. I think that's really lovely. And I mean, our kids now are quarter English, quarter Nepalese, quarter Punjabi, quarter Sardar. Sister's married to a Chinese guy, born and brought up in England. So we're also that kind of cocktail.
Yeah.
And I think celebrating differences, keeping on learning, appreciating who you are, whoever you are. Or if you're all of one thing, that's great too. I think celebrating who you are and not being afraid to be that is just so important.
Totally.
So on that note, Kalki, it's always so, so lovely chatting to you. And if there's anything you want to ask me.
How bad is it? Is it really bad?
The pain? Okay, so honestly, I'm quite, you know me, I don't really abuse
much. Is there a moment of panic where you're like, I just don't think I'm going to get through this?
Yeah, so you know, okay.
She's saying yeah.
No, I'll tell you. So for our first baby, who's now 10, I thought I was just going to be this superwoman, superhuman, whatever, because the pregnancy was relaxed and, you know, so I thought, I won't take anything. And I went through the pain, the labor and stuff. It was actually quite chilled out. I'd read, I'd, you know, listened to the few people that I'd chosen to listen to. And then I remember I also had my gynec, Dr. Firoz Poonawalla. He was very chilled out and he would joke around a lot. So when we came in, he was like, listen, guys, hurry up. I need to go to bar night. And that worked for someone like me because I'm quite a worrier. So I quite liked the fact that he was relaxed.
Right.
And then
to be honest, those contractions, they start getting closer and closer, and the pain isn't really, again, everyone's situation is different.
Yeah.
But for me, the water didn't burst. It was burst. So it's different for everyone.
Right.
But then at that, when it started getting really painful, I remember my dad said, listen, don't be like trying to be some, you don't have to prove anything to anyone. Yeah. Do what works for you. Took the epidural, was really comfortable. That was first delivery. Second one, I decided I'll take the epidural earlier. Mm. And everything was calm, calm, calm. Then it wore off. And I was screaming expletives. Man. And, you know, it was very unlike me. But unless you come to our house on a bad day, then you'll hear enough of that. But yeah, so wow. I think be prepared for anything.
Right.
But whatever it is, it'll be amazing. I'm sure.
Intolerable pain, but it'll be amazing.
It'll be amazing. I'm going to like see you very soon after, and I'm going to hear what you have to say about that moment when you hold your
little one. Yes.
Thank you, Kalki, and a huge, huge congratulations. I'm getting up to give you lots of hugs.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You know, I have an air purifier and it measures quality and it goes different colors. And many times it's red, which is like toxic air.
I know.
Like, why is no one talking about this or doing anything about it?
Next week, we meet veteran actor Soni Razdan and her beautiful, talented daughters, author Shaheen and superstar actor Alia Bhatt, who are raising awareness on mental health.
Now we live in an age where there's a lot of sharing, whether it's mental health, depression.
It's very important to share, and it would be very hypocritical of me to say that it's important to share but then shy away from sharing myself.
And some helpful tips for families and children.
What's very important to tell parents is that you have to look for signs. You have to know what they are and you have to look for them.
Absolutely.
To create that atmosphere where everybody can say what they want is very important.